What I'm gonna...
Jim?
Yep. Oh, let me have it. Let me have it. Good. Can you all hear me?
Yep.
All right. This is we're gonna troubleshoot our gardens. And I've had this year more questions from all of you than I've had in all the years I've been here. I'm just getting a ton of them. So I felt, well, why are we doing it this way? Let's get us all together and talk. So I'm gonna really troubleshoot a garden. And then I wanna open it all up to questions. So if you have anything you wanna shoot with me, I'm here. And we can just go with it from there. I have 14 points I want to address with your garden. And just to let you know, this microphone is new to me, so. By the way, thanks for coming. Did you all have a good Fourth before we get busy?
Yeah.
You know, I got to ask you a question because I've been asking this all last month. What happened on the 4th of July historically to give us a Fourth to celebrate? Do you, any of you know?
Nothing.
What did we do historically? Why are we celebrating the 4th of July? I didn't get a single answer out of everybody I asked. And it was on TV this morning. We signed our Declaration of Independence. Yes, we're independent. So that's what we did. We don't just shoot off fireworks and have a lot of fun and drink beer. Anyway, okay, enough of that talk. I'm gonna go through 14 points and address 14 things that can go wrong or what you should do in a garden. The problem is we have so much literature out there, so much to read, magazines and books, on the internet, whatever the case may be, and there's a ton of information out there, and trying to decipher through all that information can be a real problem. I've gone through a lot of it myself, and I finally decided enough is enough. I'm going to just start working at it myself and find out what works and what doesn't work. So that's where we're headed. Okay, start off. These are the things we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about plant hardiness. I get asked that a lot. We have people coming down from the Canadian border. What's the hardiness zone up there? Do any of these plants work up there? What works here? Okay, dividing plants, and we're going to actually divide a hosta. Moving plants. I was just asked that today. Pests, varmints, and unwanted guests. We're going to talk about that. Pesticides, soils. And soils is perhaps the largest and the most important subject we're going to talk about today. Planting, potting, fertilizing and composting, watering. And I had a gentleman here just last week. He wanted to know what Michigan native plants we had. And I said, well, what's the question? I just want to know what I can purchase that I don't have to water. So watering is huge, and we'll talk about that. Weeding, storm damage, hail, that's a big one. And there's been some university studies done on that. Winter kill and winter protection. Plant location, and that's the sun versus shade. Where do you put the plant? And we're going to talk about keeping plants healthy. Believe me, that's the absolute first thing we want to address is keeping your plants healthy. All right. So let's start off with plant hardiness. Do you know what our hardiness zone is in this area?
Four.
That's right. We're a four. We are a true four. I put even zone 6 plants in my garden and successfully brought them through. The point is, I want you to understand something. We are a true 4, not a 5. And you'll see a lot of things out there that are 5s. We'll talk about that. But the point is, if you have a zone 4 plant in the garden, you're going to succeed with it. It'll get through that winter and do just fine. If you have a 5, it may make it through. And I'll show you how you can do that. But it will struggle, and you will get a plant back, but not as large as you'd hope for. So just be alert to that fact, that when you purchase plants, if you buy a zone 4 plant, you're going to succeed. And that's probably where you should go in the first place. Dividing plants. That's another question I constantly get asked. So I want to divide hosta. By the way, how many of you have been here and seen me divide hostas? Oh my gosh, you guys. But not all of you. So let's divide another one. You keep coming back. Yeah, I know. I know. All right. First of all, I want to mention you don't divide a hosta in spring. Please do not divide a hosta in spring. You do it in late summer or fall, preferably late summer. Why? Because when you divide in the springtime, a hosta is coming out of the ground and it's growing and it's sending up leaves. It's sending up shoots and leaves. If you divide a hosta at that time, you're putting that plant at tremendous risk of failing, because a hosta doesn't grow roots until the leaves are up and out and running. So a hosta has two flushes. The first flush that comes out of the ground, those are those little nubs that you see coming out of the ground, will emerge in the formation of a leaf. That's the first flush. When that sets off, you'll start sending up a second flush. And that's what a hosta does, two flushes. Now, if you decide to go in there and split or divide a hosta, while they're in the process of doing that, you're putting the plant at risk. And again, I want to emphasize it's because they aren't growing roots at that time. So what you're doing is you're dividing a hosta and you're putting it back in the ground with the old roots. Now, some of those shoots, some of the newer shoots that are coming out won't have roots. Secondly, in the spring, we have fluctuations of temperature and wind and rain and you name it. We can have cold spells and we can have 3 or 4 days of real hot spells. Now, if you have a new division you just put back in the ground that doesn't have new roots yet, you really put that plant at risk. You can fail. So when you divide a hosta, you do it in late summer, because that's the time when it has everything it needs to survive and it will grow new roots. So keep that in mind. Now I'm going to divide a hosta. This is Hosta Mike, and it's one of our own creations, and we've been dividing these to try to get more on the market so that more of you can have and enjoy this plant. And this one now has two shoots, so I'm going ahead and dividing it. This is now July. It's a good time to divide. It has and will have more roots. So, let's see, there we are. Okay. Oh, thank you. The first thing you're going to do is just shake off all the dirt. One thing you don't do when you divide a hosta is take a shovel and cut right through it. I used to do that. I don't do that anymore. So you remove as much of that dirt as possible. Wash it off. You now have a plant you can see. And you can see we have two shoots joined in the center. Lots of roots. So what you want to do is take a razor blade. Thank you. Now you can hear me? And try to find a place on here where you're not going to be cutting through a lot of roots. If you do a perfect job, you'll have all the roots kept intact. If you did this with a shovel, you'd probably have 15, 20 roots on the ground left over. So you just start cutting where those two roots, where the two stems come together, and just start cutting as best as you can without cutting yourself. And start splitting the plant
And she's starting to go right now. Can you see that? And she comes apart real nice. There, see that? Now you just very carefully she's already divided, but now I don't want to tear her roots. Because they're pretty tangled up in here. See that? You've got two plants. I didn't lose one root. That's dividing a hosta. And you can do the same thing to any plant you want right now, pretty much. So it doesn't have to just be a hosta. You can, if you have any plant you want to divide, ferns divide real easily, and so forth and so on. And that's how you do it, with a razor. Just pull it out of the ground and get the soil off so you can see the root zone, and get a razor blade and just cut it through. Now, we have two plants.
When are you going to take questions?
We'll do the, that's a good question. We'll do the questions after I finish.
Okay.
So maybe I'll answer a lot of those questions while I'm going along. And if I haven't, you can just come after me. Whoops, let's, here, I'm going to put this in here. Whoops, I'm tripping over my own stuff. Okay, there we are. Put it right in there. Okay, where's my notes? Are they in here? Where'd they go?
Right there.
Oh, yeah. Okay, we're going
to talk
about
moving plants. You can move a plant anytime you want. If you just dig in and around that plant and dig up a ball of soil with the roots, right, you got it. So the plant doesn't even know it's been moved. But before you move it, make sure you have a spot to put it in. And that's what we're going to get into as we go further on. It's very important that you know where you're going to put it instead of just putting a ball of dirt with a plant in it off someplace waiting to be put into the garden. Pests, varmints, and unwanted guests. That's a huge one. And we're talking about deer and rabbits, voles, moles, insects, viruses, nematodes, Japanese beetles, rust, and mildew. And the list just keeps going. As we go along here, I want to emphasize one thing, and that is getting and keeping your plants healthy, and they'll do just fine, even with all the pests. Even with the slugs, they'll do just fine, as long as you keep the plants healthy. And that's where I'm especially headed with this whole thing, is to try to show you how to keep a garden up and running and keep the health going. So as far as pests, I don't deal with it. My worst one is deer, and I'm going to tell you a truth. Deer love ferns. They'll eat them. And they'll tell you right away in literature, everywhere you look, it's deer-proof, and it's not. Of course, they love hostas, we all know that. We've had that problem, and other plants. So a deer will eat anything if he wants to. And I also found out that I have newborns every year in my area, and they just have to come into my garden, where the older guys seem to know to stay out. And it's the newborns that do the eating and finding out it didn't taste good. So that's what attacked me this year on my fern garden I just put up. All right, pesticides. We have pests and varmints. And I'm sure at the end of this whole lecture, you're going to ask me, what do I have and how do I get rid of it? But as far as pesticides are concerned, and we're talking about things that you can use for viruses or nematodes or insects or whatever the case may be, I want to emphasize one thing. What is my number? I'm a retired entomologist and parasitologist. I spent all my years at the university level working with some pretty bad stuff. In fact, when I finished all of that, I went in and got a complete examination to find out if there's anything that's still with me that I got to be careful with. And I've had cancer. So that's where I want to emphasize this. I don't use pesticides of anything anymore, except for one product, We'll talk about that one. I keep heading that way. But the one product you don't ever want to use, and I'm going to say this, and you probably, I just have to say it because it scares me more than anything, and that's Roundup. I don't use Roundup without fail. It's a defoliator, and it'll cause non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. That's a real cancer getter. For that simple reason, I don't live near golf courses because they use a lot. And all it takes is a breeze or a small wind to blow it into your yard and contaminate you. But I don't buy Roundup. I don't use Roundup. I won't touch it. I won't look at it. It's not in my garage. One of the biggest problems we have with insecticides or any kind of pesticide is you walk into Walmart, you can go in all these stores and you'll see shelves with this stuff. And the question always comes into mind, what do I buy? You have to understand a lot of these pesticides, the pesticides that really work, have to be handled by a licensed operator. They're the only ones that can really handle it safely. We can't, because we don't know how. So what's happened is, to make it an approximation of what is out there, we weaken the solution to a point where, okay, Johnny can handle it, but it's weak, so it doesn't really work. But what you've done is you purchased it and you hope you got rid of the Japanese beetle, or whatever the case may be. It doesn't work, particularly with nematodes, because that was something I worked very, very hard at. And I only found out that all the pesticides that were out there that killed nematodes had to be handled by a licensed operator. The ones we could buy didn't require a licensed operator, but it didn't work. It just didn't have it. The concentrations were so low. And that's what's happening. So when you're in there buying a product you think is going to do the job, it probably won't, except one. And it's the safest one to use. And that's insecticidal soap. How many people use it and have used it? It's a good product. It's a product that'll work for aphids and sucking insects that you have on your plant. And it doesn't hurt you and it doesn't hurt the plant. And you just spray it on. The problem is what happens with, if you want to call it a problem with insecticidal soap, is you have to actually spray the insect. It's not a residual insecticide, so that you can spray the plant and walk away and hope you've hit your problem for a long time. It doesn't do that. You've got to find your aphids and spray the aphids. But insecticidal soap is a pretty safe insecticide, so I'm going to recommend that. It's not something you have to be afraid of. But everything that's out there right now, believe me, don't buy it. So how do you handle this? You handle it, again, I'm going to come right back at you, by keeping your plants healthy. They can do it themselves. You know, even trees give off of a gaseous material that is equivalent to the same gaseous material that's coming out of the exhaust of our cars. And it affects the ozone layer. But why do they have it? They have it to eradicate noxious insects from coming at them. Plants do this, and they can, and they will. Leave them alone. Just get the garden up and healthy. And I can't stress that enough. Talk louder? Okay. All right. Like that? All right. Soils. That's where I'm headed with all of this. Now you can hear me? Okay. Soils. That's the most important thing you can do to your garden. And I use a lot of leaf material in my gardens, shredded leaves. The other thing is, a lot of people come at me, they say, well, geez, I've got all these plants already in my garden. How do I start going in there and manipulating or changing the soils? Every time you plant, you should be changing the soils. Okay, this is a 10-gallon bucket right here. In the fall, I bury my gardens with 6 to 8 inches of leaves. And in the spring, I rake the leaves off. And those leaves get piled on the edges of the garden, right along my trees. So every time I plant, every time I move a plant, Every time a manipulator worked the soils of any sort, I add leaves. So a lot of people then ask you, well, how many leaves do I use? This is a 10-gallon container.
Right here.
This is a 10-gallon container.
When I move a plant, let's say I dug a plant up and I want to move it to another location, this is what I use. Right there. That's how many leaves go on that spot where that new plant's going. So then you take a shovel and turn that into the soil.
So what I have now is a soil right in this area that's half leaves and half soil, 50-50. Now, when that's done, and you can see this is how many leaves I have. These are leaves that came off the garden this spring that I had on top of that garden in the fall. And you can see they're already shredded. You don't have to shred them. This is the best mulch you can have. And there's a reason why you're putting this on your soil. What happens over the years, you get a lot of rain and you're watering and you're walking and you're in your garden and it's compacting. When the soil becomes compact, take a shovel like this and just go into that soil like this. Now, if that can't go into the soil as easily as you would like it to without your foot getting on that shovel and forcing it in, you have compacted soils. That is a very unhealthy environment for a plant. Why? For two reasons. One, it has no oxygen. It just doesn't have any oxygen. And a plant needs oxygen at the root zone to thrive. It may survive, but it's not thriving. The other thing is, once you've added this material to your soil, it's water retentive. Do you understand? Every time it rains and every time you water, the soil holds moisture. So you don't have to continually water. How many people, you know, we've had a lot of rain. How many people here have watered their gardens since the last rainstorm? Nice going, guys. Seriously. I did a major watering yesterday and I finished up this morning. The garden was starting to get dry. A lot of people say, well, look at all the water we've had. Yes, we had. But one thing you want to do when you're watering a garden is the fact that when a soil starts to dry out, don't water when you think it's dry. You water it before you think it's drying out. For the simple reason, you'll have water runoff from a sprinkler if you water a dry garden. If it's already somewhat moist, it'll soak the moisture up. And if you have a leaf mulch in that soil, you have a healthy soil that's going to absorb as much water as it can. It'll have oxygen. And by the way, a compacted soil has no worms or very few, and soil microorganisms are almost gone to that point where it's not doing anything to anybody or any plant. So if you want the worms to come back, you want moisture to stay in the soil, and especially you want oxygen to come back to that soil and you have a healthy plant, you've got to go with a mulch. Now, if you don't have dead leaves, you can go to peat moss or anything that's organic. You can even throw bark in there if you want. Shredded cypress, anything you see in bags, they sell them at gas stations. Just start adding them to your soil and you're going to have a healthy garden. Fertilizing. That's another aspect that a lot of people ask, what do I do to fertilize? The first thing I use is a product called Milorganite. Do you know what that is? It's one of the best products you could ever use. It comes in a large bag. It's a lawn fertilizer. It's sold right along with Scott's Lawn Pro and all the others. You can buy it at Fleet Farm. Why is it so good? Because it comes from the Milwaukee Treatment Sewage Plant. It's human waste. They've learned to bake it, pulverize it into a fine powder, and you can just, what I do is,
I have an ice cream bucket. An ice cream bucket is, it's a fine powder. Uh-huh. And all you do is just toss it in the garden. Like that. That's all you have to do.
And you walk your garden and toss it. Now it's very high in nitrogen with a trace of iron. And it's the perfect additive to throw on your garden when the plants are first coming up in spring. I do two applications until about well into May, early June. Following that, I compost with a good farm post. Do you all know what a farm post is or a compost? It's a manure additive material. It has wood chips and some good organic material such as the leaves you see here, but it has added to that cow manure, dried cow manure. It's the best stuff you can possibly put on your garden, and you can use it all summer long as a top dressing. So every time you water or it rains, it's going to leach into the soils the nutrients that the plant's looking for. Do any of you remember Funky Gardens at the other place? Good. We did that religiously in the gardens, and we had those incredible gardens you could go and walk around in. And all those gardens were top dressed with a farmer compost. And you should be doing the same thing with your own. It's the best, and as far as I'm concerned, the only way to really add nutrients to that soil. Okay, watering. We talked about watering. When I water a garden, I water each zone of my garden for a full half hour. I have a sprinkler that goes, and it doesn't get moved until at the end of each of those half hour increments. That soil is well watered when I finish. And again, congratulations to all of you that watered even after the rains, because we should be watering now. This is already, the soils are starting to dry out. Weeding. How many like to weed? Yeah. Actually, I do too. I do. It is therapeutic. But one thing, that's another question I get asked a lot. You're sitting on a weed mat. Look at your feet. This is a weed mat. So it allows moisture and anything else you put on it to get through and into the root zone of a plant. A lot of people use weed mat on their gardens so they don't have to weed. That is absolutely the worst thing you can possibly do. There's a university study that's out there right now that has, they did a piece of research that really woke me up. They used the weed mat, and over a period of time they lifted the weed mat to see what went on underneath it. There wasn't one worm left in that soil. The soil microorganism count went way down. In a sense, you had underneath that weed mat sterile soil. It could do nothing for the plant that was trying to struggle above it. Don't use weed mat. Please enjoy weeding. So, what's an easier way to weed? I'll tell you what my way. I take a hose, and I just an open hose, and put it into the garden in the zone in the area I'm going to work. With a small trickle coming out of that hose, the ground will start getting wet. And as it's getting wet and getting wetter, you can just reach in there and start pulling weeds out with your bare hand. And they'll all come out, and you're putting them in a bucket right next to you. In fact, you'll actually floodplain your garden. Your garden will be just, at some point, quite full of water. And it allows you to just pull all those weeds right out. And how did I get to that stage? because I have a fern garden. I have a huge, but I'm quite proud of a nice fern garden. And I learned that you can't use a trowel in and around fern roots. If you do, you can really hurt the plant. That hurts ferns. So how are you going to start digging up weeds without a trowel or something? And I came to the level where I was at the point where I was just putting an open hose into the garden and letting it floodplain and pulling weeds right out. And believe me, I'm going to tell you right now, weeds will just come right out of the ground. It's the easiest thing in the world to do. Now, storm damage. Hail. How many have had hail storms and hail damage to your plants? Geez, you guys, where do you live? There was another nice study done, and that's something that I follow perfectly, right to the numbers. And that is, if you have hail damage, and particularly if you have hostas, you're going to have holes in your leaves. And in some cases, the leaves will become quite shredded. A lot of people will go in there and cut the plant down and watch for new growth to come up. Wrong. Leave the plant alone. It'll heal itself. In fact, they found out now that if you cut the plant down, wait, and many, quite often it'll come back, but the following year it'll be not nearly as large as you would hope for. If you leave the plant alone, let it come back, next year it'll come back larger and just as full as it ever was, like nothing happened. So when you get any kind of damage, hail damage, storm damage to your plants, leave them alone. Let them take care of themselves. Winter kill. That's another one. Every spring I get people coming up to me and asking me, what happened? A plant died. And this year it was shrubs and trees. And the first thing I ask them is, have you watered? Because very often if they let their plants go through a dry fall without watering, you're going to lose plants. And watering is one of those that you have to do, particularly with shrubs and trees. Now, when it comes to trees particularly, I have a habit of planting my trees right in my gardens. So as I'm watering the garden, the tree's getting watered right along with it. Or if I have a large tree, very often I'll plant gardens around and incorporate that tree into that garden so that as I'm watering, the tree is getting watered too. Shrubs likewise. So it isn't something I have to go out and single out and water. It's getting watered every time I water the garden. And believe me, my trees came back perfectly this year. And I have a dwarf conifer and some other neat things that I'm in love with. I didn't have any winter damage at all. Plant location. That's another one that a lot of people just don't understand enough. Hostas particularly. They're planting hostas in a hot zone, in a place where they have a lot of sun, or something's happening to my plant. What do I do? What you want to, there's two rules of thumb. One, never plant a hosta in an area where they're getting afternoon sun. My hosta gardens, my plants, always, they had all the morning sun that I could give them. But by noon, when I was stopping for lunch, there wasn't a bit of sun left on that garden. And I had those gardens all facing east and north. Believe me, they were getting a lot of sun in the morning, in the cool time of the day, but no sun in the afternoon, and the plants thrived. Now I'm going to tell you something. Well, let's keep going with this. Another one is when you have a lot of sunny perennials, watch the plants. I have people coming in asking why a certain plant isn't blooming or something is going wrong. Particularly, that became very evident with a phlox collection that I had. It was in an area where I had originally planted them, and the plants were doing just fine, until a tree started growing to a level where it was starting to put enough shade on the phlox where the blooming period just dropped measurably. I have a daylily collection that did the same thing. So when you have blooming perennials, when you have sunny perennials, and suddenly the bloom cycle starts to go, just starts to disappear on you. You lost your flower production, probably getting too much shade. It's time to move the plant. That's one time you want to move something into the sun rather than into the shade. Now, something I'm going to tell you about hostas, which are going to be quite interesting because a lot of people don't know this. Did you know a hosta is a sunny plant? It's a plant. Most of hostas come from Japan. There's some that come from Korea and central China. The majority of them come from Japan. All of the areas where these plants are growing natively, the species now, not the hybrids, are growing in full sun. They grow in grasslands, on the edges of woods, and on sheer cliffs over huge gorges where they have a lot of water coming through. And they're hanging on rock faces in areas where they are getting a lot of sun. And what's happened is the Japanese finally opened up their area to allow the Western world to start enjoying some of their plants. And the first hostas that came out of Japan went to London, England. They were huge collectors. From there, they came over to this country. During those times, the nursery operators discovered hostas do well in shade. They were the ones that decided a hosta is a shade plant. And that's why today we're all putting our hostas in shade. However, I'm going to back up. I want to emphasize to all of you, you don't put a hosta in afternoon sun. It's not the sun that's the problem, it's the heat. The heat will burn a hosta, and especially in our summer heat. When you put hostas in full morning sun, it's getting all sun. It's the cool time of the day, and it's doing just fine, and it's thriving. It's growing better than it ever did. It's doing everything you want it to do, but it's the afternoon sun where it starts to go downhill. Especially by late summer, they're burning. And that's now you really know your plant is stressed. Yes, they like sun, but it's the cool time of the day. It's the temperature that's the problem in all of these cases. Okay, keeping plants healthy. That's trimming and cutting plant densities. You're thinning your plants out. Drainage and staking, all of these. Get to know your garden and know your plants, particularly the soils underneath them. If your plants are doing well, I can guarantee you it's probably the soils. That's where your problem exists. Again, I want to get back to pests and insects and everything. If the plant is healthy and it's doing what it should do, you don't have to even worry about the pests. For even Japanese beetles, that's something that doesn't even affect me. And I know they're in my yard. It doesn't bother me. I have a porcelain vine. These beetles come in and literally strip it. But next year, that vine is right back and doing well. It's a healthy plant, that's why. All right, enough said. Any questions? No. That's fine. That's fine. A weed mat will hold back. No, especially cypress mulch and things like that are just fine. And so is newspaper. That's fine too. That's right. And by the way, pine needles will not acidify your soil. Don't expect it. A lot of people use it for that purpose. They put it on their blueberry bushes and you name it. The reason for it is because the water we have comes from an aquifer that's very, very alkaline. We have dolomite limestone underneath us in this whole area. So the water coming out of your hose is coming out of an aquifer that is highly alkaline. So if you're putting pine needles on there hoping to acidify the soil, it's going to neutralize it every time. But it's good for all of that, yeah. It's great. Yeah, I still pull them all out by hand. Yes. What's that? Yes. If you're watering with an open hose, it'll eventually just floodplain your garden. So I have just, everything is in water. And that doesn't bother me at all. I mean, the plants love that anyway. Then you can start pulling weeds right out. They'll come right out. If you have real compact soils, then you may have a problem. That's another indication you need to do something. By the way, if you have a garden and you say to yourself, well, geez, there's no way I'm going to put all those leaves in my garden because I've already got an established garden and a lot of plants, at least water. Just get a lot of water on that garden and do it judiciously and be very attentive to it. Don't water until the garden dries out to water it the second time. Just keep watering and you'll eventually open that soil up to the point where you're going to start getting your worm growth back. Another thing too I want to mention is one thing that I do in my garden is I never walk in the garden. I never walk on any part of that garden. My plants are accessible to paths. I have paths all over in my garden. And I use broken cypress bark for that. And every plant I have in my garden, I can get to it without walking in that garden. I wouldn't put a foot in my soil if you paid me, because it only compacts the soil. It'll really do some major damage. Yeah. It is effective. It's effective on dogs or pets or anything else that walks on it. There's always signs on there. Crossbone signs and everything else. Don't walk on the lawn. Well, I don't use it. Yeah, I would stay out of the effect of wind and wind and air currents that can pull that over to you. Get out of there. Yeah.
Is that a deer repellent?
Yeah, it is. Because it comes from human waste, it has just enough human scent in it that can act as a deterrent to deer and rabbits. In fact, when I started using it some years ago, I haven't had a rabbit problem since. I have not had a single rabbit. None. But I still need to educate the deer a few times, yeah. Yes. And good. Just be careful using it on and on throughout the summer. You're giving too much nitrogen to your plant. Good. You're good. Yeah. And you know, right? You can't smell it, but they do. They do. That's right. By the way, I wanted to show you a couple things that I have that I wouldn't be without when I garden. So I'm going to put the microphone down and show it to you. This is just kind of a show and tell time.
I have my favorite tools, and this is one of them. And why do I like it? Because
I can get... I love this tool because I can go right in between plants with it. It just goes right in and I could just loosen weeds or do anything I want with it. I could loosen soil, and it's just a great way to kind of cultivate the soil. And it only has one fork, just one. That's all I need. But I can get into tight places. This is definitely one tool. When I go into the garage and start working on my garden, I know it's going to be an all-morning event. This is a tool that comes out first, right away. This is a huge tool for me. How many have? have these. Yeah, aren't they neat? This is a kneeling pad. And you just go down like this, and you can put all your weight on the arms, and just go down like that, and it just started working. Now, when I'm floodplaining my garden, so it's a lot of, there's a lot of water down in here, it's not touching my pants at all. Oh, this one came from a Walmart. They had it. But they're all over. So I have my knees are on something soft. I'm starting to go through it. But the whole point is I have to have this. I won't work in a garden until I do. And there's another reason why it's so good. And sit on it and have a glass of wine. And I just love it. So it's a chair and I can kneel on it. It does everything. And believe me, I have to tell you, every morning, I'm usually working in the garden every morning. I work until about noon because that's when the day heats up too much. I'm pulling out all my favorite tools and just laying right in the grass. And the one I just showed you gets laid out there. Certainly my stool gets laid out there. And some of my rakes and shovels, and that's it. And when I'm finished, they go back in. But these tools, I just won't do without. There's one more. I can't do it without my duct tape. I'm repairing everything with it. Believe me, I go through a spool like this in quite short order. So, are there any questions?
If you want, now that was a pretty simple split for that. What
right.
About if you have a big hosta and you just want to, take a part of it off?
You still have, you still dig it up, put
the
it,
whole plant?
The whole plant.
Oh, okay.
Even if it's a big one that you want to divide, or just break a piece off, you still have to dig it up. And then if it's too big to put into a flower pot, I mean into a watering can or whatever, a pail, then you just wash it all off with a hose. But you have to expose the roots.
Okay. To make a nice separation.
That's right. And you notice when I did that, I had two perfect plants. That plant never knew it was divided. And so the two can be potted up or put back at the garden. That's something else I want to mention to you. Planting and potting. I didn't mention that to you, and that's a pretty important step. The first thing you want to do is plant a plant. Let's say you bought a plant at a nursery, or you transplanted a plant. You've got to put it back in the ground. How do you plant a plant? It's amazing all the different procedures that people do. And if you look at on any of the channels for House and Garden, that's channel 41 for my TV, you'll see those guys putting plants back in the garden, and they're digging holes. Some guys with a big shovel digging a hole, and somebody else is taking a plant out of a pot and throwing it right in the hole, and it's dry. And then they're putting soil back in. And then later, somebody is drowning the plant with a hose. This is just kills me when I see that. And those guys are supposed to be professionals. What you want to do is, first of all, I add a lot of leaf mulch to my soil. So that leaf mulch is 50-50 soil and leaf mulch. Then I dig a hole right in the middle, the center of that leaf mulch. Then I go over and dig a plant up at someplace else in the garden, and you're going to move it. So you bring the plant, you've dug a plant up, you brought it over, and you put it down in that hole. Now you take a pail of water and fill the hole up with water. Just completely fill it to the top. Now you put the excess soil and leaf mulch into that, right into the water. And what that does is it waters the plant. You don't have to sit over it with a hose. And secondly, with the water in there, there won't be any air pockets. This plant will be fully watered in, and the plant will never know it's been moved. So leaf mulch the garden, dig a hole, go over and get the other plant, put it in the hole, fill the hole with water. Now you put the soil back in. The plant will never know it's been moved. And moving plants, I do it all the time. It's constantly being asked of me, can I move a plant? I am moving plants almost weekly. It's just something I do. In fact, somebody told me, you got to stop moving those hostas around because they won't grow if you keep moving them. Well, nevertheless, I move plants. And it's a nothing to do. Now, if you buying plants, that's another thing you've got to be concerned about. If you come into a nursery in the spring and you bought some plants and you're ready to put it in the garden, don't. Because it's more than likely it's a plant that's just been potted up. It's probably a small plant to begin with. You don't want to take that out of pot and put it in the garden. You're going to stress the plant. So what I do with all the plants I buy at a nursery in the spring, I put it in the garden where I want the various pots to go. Then I dig a hole and sink the pot right in that hole, right up to the rim. Smooth the soil around, go to the next one. Dig a hole, sink the pot. So all the plants now are in the garden where you want it to go in the first place, but they're still in the potting soil that they came in. And that's the best thing you can do for that plant because it's struggling at this point. It was just potted up. And this is a very loose soil with a lot of added nutrients. So it's getting fed, and it's an easy soil for the new roots to grow into. If you put newly potted plants into a garden of heavy soils, but if you added leaf mulch, at least you're helping that along. But if it's a heavy soil, it's going to struggle a lot harder than it would if it was in a pot with potting soil. So that's one thing to try to remember. Now, if you get plants by mail order and they're showing up at your doorstep, UPS, which I am doing all the time because I always go shopping on the internet, you open the box and pull the plants out and pot them up in potting soil just like you would if you were at a nursery. You don't put those plants right in the garden. So you take the plants and put them in a pail of water for about a half an hour to an hour. Let them let them soak up the moisture. Now pot the plants up in a pot. Sink the pot like you would any plant you buy in the spring. Now you ask yourself, well, when do I put it in the garden? Once in a while, I'll go out there and I'll pull a pot out of the ground and see if there's any roots growing through the bottom of the pot. Particularly hostas will do that. You'll start seeing roots coming through the holes. It's time to take it out. Now you can go ahead and put it in the garden. Some plants you can't quite do that with, particularly trillium, because I collect trillium and some of the ferns and so forth. That's all right. Just keep them in the pot for a good period of time to give it some time. And then you can go ahead and put it right in the ground. And each time you put it in the ground, make sure you add water before you put the soil back in. Just keep doing that. So, anything else? Any other questions? Oh, by the way, planting in fall. A lot of times I'll buy plants in the fall. I went to a nursery one time where there was a plant in there. Oh, my God, I finally found it. But it was snowing outside. So what do you do with that? Well, I went ahead and put the plant right at the... I dug a hole and buried the pot right up to the rim and left it there until spring. And it came back fine. There's a lot of thought behind that. A lot of people wouldn't dare do that. They will still take them all out of pot and make sure they're in the ground for survival over the winter. I haven't had that problem, so that hasn't been something that I've ever had to deal with. The other thing is winter survival for winter kill. That's something that I do and I'm very conscious of, and that is putting leaf mulch on my garden. And I use 6 to 8 inches of leaves on the garden. My gardens are all covered with 6 to 8 inches of leaves. So the leaves are that deep. And I have a place where I go get them. I used to have somebody deliver them, but he passed away, so now I have to go get my own. But I make sure I do. I also drive the streets, and I look for bagged leaves, because those are my favorite. So once in a while, you're going to buy a plant that's kind of on the edge. It's one maybe a zone 5, or it's a... I have two ferns that I'm very conscious of that are right on the edge of 4 and 5. And what I'll do with that is I take a garbage bag and fill it with leaves, tie it off, and I just put the garbage bag with the leaves right on top of the plant. You do that religiously to those plants that you're afraid of, and you'll save the plant. So next spring, you're going to pull that garbage bag off. And that's the next thing. When do you rake the leaves off your garden, and when do you pull the garbage bags up? Tax day. Tax day is the day I do all of that. So it's not just a day to have your taxes filed, but it's a day to rake the garden. And That's the only time. What if there's snow on the ground? We've had snow in the last 2 years, so I'm very often raking leaves well into May. But nevertheless, tax day, you wouldn't do it ever before tax day. Never before tax day. You don't even look at your garden until at least that day. Any other questions? Geez, you guys, you know all the answers. Yeah. I have a place that I buy that's called the Treehouse. I don't know if any of you know where it is. It's on 6110, right before you get into Hastings. You're at the top of the hill. There's a place called the Treehouse. They get all their compost from the University of Minnesota. It's made there. But there are other places you can buy it. Does anybody around here know where you can get compost? I think just down the road you can buy it. What's that place called, the nursery right down the road? Abraham's. I think they sell it. I think they did. I don't know. You'll have to find out. But I'm way down on the other end. And just call around. Oh, Gerdens sells it, by the way. I know Gerdens does. If you shop there, you can buy it there. Because I just found that out. Yeah. And again, some of these places, like at the Treehouse where I get my compost, they'll deliver right to your house. I don't have a truck, so I have them delivered. And they just put it in the driveway, and our cars are parked on the street for a while. Any other questions? All right, thank you for coming.
Thank you. I have a question about those guys. Do you know about tomato plants? My tomato plants are turning yellow.
You gotta feed them.
Okay.
That's a problem.
We were afraid at first that we might have over-fertilized, but...
It's a nutrient problem.
I sprayed it with the Miracle-Gro, you know, the whole thing. And
right. It's a miracle. It is a nutrient problem.
Will Lorgonite help that too? Or?
No, because that only is high in nitrogen. It won't do anything for that.
Okay, so spray it with the Miracle-Gro tomato feed?
Yeah, tongue and cheek. You could either that or just put some good compost on it.
Okay.
Which would be a natural way to do it.
And we were wondering, because when we did it the first time with the hose thing, it doesn't really tell you how much to put on. It just said kind of make a crisscross pattern, but
no, you just, I do this with each plant.
Oh, okay.
Like that. So if this plant, I'm just doing this.
Okay.
And you don't have to do the dirt, just the plant.
Okay.
Just kind of
just
do
the
that.
Oh, you don't do the dirt, just spray the plant.
It's a foliar feed.
Okay.
It's not eating down through the roots, right. It's eating through the leaves.
Okay. Yeah. I'll go home and do that this afternoon.
But if you can get some good compost, that's the best way to go. Because every time you water, you're going to be adding nutrients and soil.
Yeah. All right, cool. Thank you.
You bet.
Where did you find the Ortho Elementals? I was looking for it and I couldn't find it anywhere.
That?
Yeah.
I got that at Walmart.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Sure. You bet.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I appreciate that.
Sure.